The Game Boy doesn't have enough buttons, so let's add one.
This is the button we're going to add, and this is how we're going to add it to the Game Boy. It's my very practical homemade flash cart. Right now it's set up to be the simplest cartridge possible, a 32K ROM with no RAM. And we're going to change that. We're going to hook up this button so that when the Game Boy reads from a cartridge RAM address, instead of getting RAM data from the cartridge, it's going to get the state of the button. One thing we're going to need to do is have a way of detecting when the Game Boy is trying to read from RAM so that we can activate the button or have a way of getting the button state. So we're going to need a few things. We're going to need a way of getting the button state, and we're going to need a way of detecting when the Game Boy is trying to read from cartridge RAM so that we can, I guess, activate the button. And we're also going to need to make sure we're not interfering with any other functionality of the cartridge or the Game Boy. We don't want to be sending data over the data bus if the Game Boy is trying to read from the ROM chip or from anything else that goes over the main bus. The first thing we're going to do is hook up this other solderless breadboard with power connections. Some nice handy hookup wire. Right, so we'll hook up the positive and positive rails and the negative and negative rails. All right, so that's going to give us power to the board. The first thing we're going to tackle is how to detect when the Game Boy is trying to read from the cartridge RAM, so when it's trying to get the state of the button. And we're going to do that by taking advantage of the signals that the cartridge gets when the Game Boy is reading from cartridge RAM, in particular the chip select signal and the A14. So when the Game Boy tries to read from cartridge RAM, chip select, the CS pin in the cartridge goes low, and all cartridge RAM addresses have A14 equal to zero. So we can know that the Game Boy is trying to read from cartridge RAM, or in this case the button, whenever chip select and A14 are both low values or logical zero. If you want to think about that in terms of logic, then basically, it's equivalent to not CS and not A14, which is equivalent to using the NOR operator. And that's what I have here. This is a little NOR chip. It consists of four NOR circuits, each with two inputs. And so what the NOR does is the NOR becomes true whenever its two inputs are false. Or the NOR will output a 1 whenever its two inputs are zeros. And that's exactly what we want to detect if the Game Boy is trying to read from cartridge RAM. So we're going to need to hook up this chip to the 5 volts and ground. That's the ground pin. And this is the VCC, so 5 volts. And now we're going to want to hook up the A14 line from the cartridge and the chip select line. Right here, right above the data pins. And I'll put it into the first input of the first NOR. And A14 is down here. And plug that into second input. Okie dokie. And so now the output of this chip will basically be high when we want to output the value of the button. Now, the idea is we're gonna connect the output of this NOR chip to one of the sides of the button, and then the other side of the button will connect to one of the data lines, probably D0. So the idea being when the Game Boy is trying to read the button state, it will have chip select low and A14 low, which will cause the output of the NOR to be high, and that'll go to the button, and if the button is pressed, it'll pass that high signal out back over to D0. But what happens when the button's not pressed? If the button's not pressed, we still need to have a signal. To get a signal, we're going to use what's called a pull-down resistor, so that when there's nothing being driven from the button, it'll default to a low value. We're going to connect a blue wire So this should be D0. And we're going to connect it over here. So it's not connected to the button quite yet. That's just because we need enough space. And now I'm going to have this resistor, which is a 4.7K resistor, and I'm going to connect it from where this blue line connects to ground. So that's the pull-down resistor. And like I said, that resistor is going to make the signal go to a low value whenever nothing is driving it. The value of it should be such that it won't interfere if, let's say, the ROM is trying to set the D0 pin. So it shouldn't interfere with normal operations of the rest of the ROM chip, and if the button's not being pressed when the Game Boy is trying to read the button, it'll default to a low or a zero value. So now connect the button output to there. All right, now I need to connect the output from the logic chip to the other side of the button. But now I have to be careful because I want to make sure whenever the Game Boy is not trying to check the state of the button, the output of the logic chip is going to be zero or a low value. And if the button is being pressed, if we connected the output of the logic chip directly to the button, then we would have basically an open path to ground with no resistance between it. Whenever any signal on D0 is high, it'll get shorted down to ground. And that's not exactly what we want. So to prevent that, we're going to use a diode. And a diode basically makes it so that the electricity can only go in one direction. So it'll prevent that backwards connection from happening. Perfect. And a yellow line from here. All right. So now this should hopefully have no impact on anything. So right now, without any code that specifically reads from the ROM, from the cartridge RAM, it just shouldn't change the functionality of the cartridge at all, even when the button's being pressed. So the next thing we need to do is to write some code for it. So this is the code I came up with. What it's doing is it checks the button, and if the button isn't pressed, it'll show a blank screen, and if the button is pressed, it'll show a little graphic. So we're going to need a graphic to do this, and I can use my Pic2GB little web app and download the binary files for tile map and tile set. And we can include those here at the bottom like this. And you notice I use a start and end label for both of these. That's so that I can easily know how big the data is that I need to copy. Right now it's stored in the ROM and it's going to need to be copied to the Game Boy's VRAM. So let's have a look at this code. At the top is just some basic boilerplate to get things started. Down here is the start of our code. And the first thing we do is wait for vblank to happen so that we can turn off the display and start setting up our graphics. Once we've turned off the display, we set the background palette and then write all zeros to tile map zero so that will be our blank screen when the button isn't pressed. Next, we need to copy over the tile data and the tile map. First the tiles, then the tile map. Next, we can turn the screen back on and set up our interrupts so that we have an interrupt when vblank occurs, because that's where we're going to check the button and update the display. Now onto our main loop, and the first thing we do is halt. And we're halting because the way halt works is the Game Boy will go into a low power mode until an interrupt occurs. And we only set up the vblank interrupt, so basically it's going to wait until vblank. And then once we get out of this halt, we know it's in vblank, and first thing we do is clear interrupt flags, and then we go on to checking our button. We wired our button up to be read when the cartridge RAM is being read, and it'll respond to any cartridge RAM or save RAM address. So we just need to read from one save RAM address. This is the first save RAM address. Then we check if bit 0 is 0. If it is 0, then we know the button wasn't pressed. And if it's not 0, we know it was pressed. If the button is pressed, we need to switch the display to start using tile map 1, and then we can jump back over to the main loop and halt again. If the button isn't pressed, we need to make sure we're still using tile map 0. We can actually test this out, and we can reload the ROM. So it thinks the button's pressed. Let's go into the debugger. And we can modify the SRAM data in the debugger and set it to 0, and the button should go away. Yep. And we can set it back to 1. And button's back. All right, so everything should work. Let's copy the ROM over to the chip. And let's put the chip in here. And I'm going to use the FPGBC because it's a little bit easier to film. So it starts up fine. Screen's blank, which is what we want. But what happens when we press the button? Button. It works. Yeah. Well, that's pretty neat. Yeah, I'm happy that worked out. I wasn't entirely sure if the circuit was going to be fine and if everything would work. Of course, this won't work with arbitrary ROMs and will probably cause problems if a ROM ever tries to write to the cartridge RAM, because the logic I'm using is basically won't differentiate between a read and a write from cartridge RAM. So it'll try to activate the button and the button will send data onto the data bus regardless. But yeah, this is pretty neat. And it kind of goes to show you how flexible the Game Boy can be. You can really add whatever you want as long as you can get the logic right and carve out a space from the memory addresses. So yeah, I hope you found this interesting. Maybe I'll do some more silly things with this cartridge in the future. Let me know in the comments if there's anything you'd like to see me hook up to a Game Boy. And bye!